Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Rajka Tharath and today I shall be discussing the implications of being a dental patient in the time of COVID-19 pandemic. COVID-19, the disease that is caused by the novel coronavirus SARS-CoV-2, is a highly contagious disease with a rapid velocity of transmission. The disease appears to have a fatality rate that is lower than its predecessors, that is SARS-CoV-1 and MERS-CoV-2. And majority of fatality appears to be in the elderly patients and in those with an existing underlying chronic condition like cardiovascular disease, hypertension, diabetes mellitus, as well as chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and in those with a weakened immune system. However, there are individuals who are young and healthy and who have succumbed to the disease, as a result of which there is widespread apprehension not only in the general population, but also in those who belong to the medical and allied healthcare sectors. As per reports, about 80% of the cases have symptoms which are mild and similar to those seen during the cold and flu season, which include fever, coughing, sneezing, as well as sore throat. About 15% of the cases get severely sick with progressive development of respiratory symptoms like shortness of breath and pneumonia. About 5% of the cases get critically ill and require intensive unit care support. The overall fatality has been reported to be about 2-3%. The modes of transmission include inhalation of droplets, surface contact, oral fecal route and airborne transmission, which is still being researched on, as well as contact with an asymptomatic carrier, as the incubation period is about 1 to 14 days. So, as of now, the best defense that all of us have against COVID-19 disease is awareness. Awareness about the disease itself, its evolution, and what the future holds for us in terms of vaccines as well as treatment. Also, with regards to dental care, I shall be discussing the standard universal infection control procedures so that when and if the extra precautions kick in, you will know the difference. Also, these extra precautions for the prevention of COVID-19 disease will be based on evidence which is present in current literature. We should also be aware of the directives that are being issued by public health bodies like World Health Organization with regards to social distancing, cleaning and disinfection of environmental surfaces, as well as an increased attention to hand hygiene. Please remember to wash your hands frequently as well as thoroughly for at least 20 seconds with soap and water. In absence of these, or when your hands are not visibly soiled, you can go for a hand sanitizer that contains at least 65% or more alcohol by weight. Also, if you need to cough, make sure that you do so in the crook of your elbow. Do the elephant, as we tell children. If you need to sneeze, make sure that you use a tissue, and once done, discard it properly in a bin with a lid. Wash your hands after. For those who are using surgical masks or disposable masks, make sure to wash your hands before you put them on your face, and once on your face, try to not touch them. I know it's easier said than done, but if you do end up touching, make sure to wash your hands again. Discard the mask immediately if it becomes damp. While removing the mask, make sure that you handle it from the elastics around the ears and not from the front. Once it's out, dispose it off properly in a bin with a lid and wash your hands after. Also, remember to never reuse a disposable mask. A few weeks back, US health officials have recommended the use of homemade masks as well as the non-traditional use of scarves and bandanas as masks. Experts recommend that while doing so, go for fabrics that are cotton-based and breathable as opposed to spandex polyester types, as these might harbor more pathogens. Also, at the end of the day, all fabrics get contaminated. So here are a few tips for the cleaning and disinfection. Make sure that the temperature is 80 degrees Fahrenheit or higher. Use a detergent which contains a bleaching agent or compound, as viruses do not do well at all in harsh environments. Also, extra heating time in the dryer makes sense, as this will help to evaporate the droplets and inactivate the virus. Make sure that you wash your hands after you handle these fabrics. Moving on to the coronavirus and the dental environment. All individuals involved in a dental care setting, right from the dental professionals to the dental patients, carry an increased risk of acquiring COVID-19 disease as a result of transmission as well as cross-infection. There are certain procedures which require the use of high-speed dental handpieces as well as ultrasonic scaling equipment, which generate large amounts of aerosols and droplets which are mixed with the patient's saliva as well as blood. Most dental staff as well as patients are likely to contact their oral, nasal and conjunctival mucosa with these droplets. Also, certain procedures can trigger the cough reflex, as a result of which even more droplets get added to the environment. Apart from this, most dental professionals frequently come in contact with body fluids, contaminated instruments, environmental surfaces, as well as patient materials. Thus, in a dental setting, apart from the direct and the indirect transmission routes, the airborne route also provides an additional pathway for the transmission of the pathogen. As a result of which, the dental team has to adhere to a strict infection control protocol in order to break the chain of infection and prevent the spread of disease. So, what are these infection control procedures? According to the American Dental Association, infection control procedures are the actions that are taken in a healthcare setting to prevent the spread of pathogens. The CDC, which is the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, also has recommendations for dental office infection control, which include standard universal precautions as well as transmission-based precautions. The standard universal precautions are the norm which is mostly followed in dental offices as of now. As per the standard universal precautions, they assume that all patients are potentially infected or colonized with pathogens which are capable of being transmitted in the healthcare settings. Most dental clinics as of now are only offering emergency as well as urgent dental care. In order to mitigate the spread of disease, all routine as well as elective dental procedures have been deferred to a later stage once the crisis abates. So what constitutes a dental emergency? It could be a dental condition which turns life-threatening, like uncontrolled bleeding, significant facial or oral trauma, infections like cellulitis which cause a massive amount of extra as well as intraoral swelling, which could lead to airway collapse, that is difficulty in breathing. If you need emergency attention, rush to the nearest designated emergency center. Also, if you need urgent dental care, contact your oral health care providers. Also, if you have any COVID-19 related symptoms, please do not expose others and contact your local health authorities right away. At this point in the COVID-19 outbreak, while scheduling an appointment, you might be subjected to a telescreening or a small screening on the phone with regards to COVID-19 symptoms as well as a brief travel history. While going for the appointment, make sure that either you go alone or only the necessary adult support person accompanies you. No children should be accompanying you at this point. Also, while reaching for the appointment, do so at the exact time and not prior to the appointment, as this will help to reduce the crowding in the waiting areas. Also, if you are given an option to wait in the automobile whilst the operator gets ready or for the appropriate time, do use this option. Apart from the standard disinfecting procedures that are normally followed in reception areas, you might see a few more extra precautions like visual alerts at strategic places with regards to hand hygiene, cough etiquette, as well as respiratory etiquette. Please be mindful of these. You might even see screening stations which are set up right outside the dental office to screen COVID-19 patients, potential COVID-19 patients, which involve questionnaires as well as body temperature checks with contact-free thermometers for the forehead. I'm sure the priority will be given to patients who have respiratory symptoms, as well as masks will be handed out at this point. Once in the reception area, please refrain from touching any books or any other materials that are lying around, as these might harbor pathogens. Experts say that pathogens persist on materials like copper for 2 hours, on cardboard for about 24 hours, and on glass and stainless steel for about 2 to 3 days. In the aerosols, pathogens may persist from 3 hours up to 5 days, depending upon the humidity in the environment. So, you may even want to pay closer attention to the procedures that are followed by the dentist and the dental staff to ensure that they're taking extra precautions for your safety. Even before you enter the examining room, the dental staff will have cleaned and disinfected the countertops, the dental chair, the radiography equipment, as well as other environmental surfaces. Most dental offices provide protective covers for the use of headrests, barrier tape for the armrests, and protective covers for radiographic equipments like the digital sensor that goes into your mouth. These protective covers are discarded after every patient and replaced with new ones following disinfection. If you have any queries, you can always ask the dental staff about their cleaning and disinfection procedures. And also, if you need further assurance, you may request them to please sanitize your chair and equipment in front of you. Though not advisable at this point, but for future reference, you may make this request prior to the appointment, preferably during the scheduling of the appointment. With regards to tools, the disposable tools like syringes, needles, and disposable suction tubes are discarded after every patient. The non-disposable tools or instruments are sterilized between patients. And these sterilized instruments you can see in the form of packages which are wrapped in sterilized paper or peel-back pouches placed on the examining tray and the dental chair. These packages have chemical indicators on the outside to indicate optimal sterilization. Along with that, there are few other technical details which include the processor's name as well as the date on which the instrument were sterilized and some more details regarding the sterilization process. These instruments are ideally to be opened in front of the patient right before using the instruments in their mouth. Infection control protocols also require that all dental staff involved in patient care to wear proper protective equipment, including disposable gloves, disposable masks, eyewear, as well as gowns. Make sure that you have your protective eyewear on before the commencement of any dental procedure. Also, most dental clinics follow best work practices, which include giving a pre-procedural mouth rinse to reduce the salivary microbial load, use of rubber dam isolation for containment of respiratory aerosols, then use of, especially at this point, extra oral radiography to make the procedure minimally invasive, as well as anti-detraction handpieces to prevent cross-infection. Also, at this point, the most minimal treatment will be done and the most essential, of course, in order to reduce the duration of exposure to a potential pathogen. Most dental offices also have a standard operating protocol with regards to waste disposal, as well as cleaning and disinfection of dental equipment, water lines, etc. At some point, the clinics might want to consider optimization of their ventilation. However, at this point and under these circumstances, it might not be practical to do so. So, once that appointment is over, it's your responsibility to follow some precautions. Even before you eat, drink, or touch your face, make sure to scrub your hands. Even the clothes that you wear might have brass buttons or a metal zipper. Make sure to disinfect these properly, as well as try to go into a shower right after. So, as you can see, your dental office cares for your safety and works very hard to prevent the spread of infection. The recommendations that I have discussed are subject to change as the clinical scenario evolves. However, I do hope that they help you to navigate through these troubled times. Please be mindful of the changes taking place in your local community as well as the continuous global evolution of the disease. In the meantime, keep smiling and namaste.